Hello. My favourite networking party trick is the TCP simultaneous open. What am I talking about? Well, most of the time we have a TCP server that's listening and a client that connects to it, which establishes a connection. This follows the usual three-way handshake. In the simultaneous open, very loosely speaking, two clients can create a connection between each other so long as they do it at the same time. Now, this sounds like nonsense. How can a client connect to a client? It kind of implies that a client is also a server. The problem is that when we use a word like client or server, it doesn't truly describe how TCP works. We can use TCP as a server by calling listen, or use TCP as a client by calling connect, but there's some extra flexibility for weird stuff to happen. So how does this actually work? Let's add some IP addresses and port numbers. Host 1 has an address which is all 1s, and host 2 has an address which is all 2s. We have prearranged some port numbers. So in our program running on host 1, we say, please connect to 2.2.2.2 on port 2222. By the way, you must use source port 1111. It's important to know that every TCP connection has two ports, one for each end. Normally you only care about the port on the server, but the client always needs one as well. Usually we let the operating system choose a free port at random, but here it's important that we specify 1111. This results in a SYN packet being transmitted. If you'll allow me to anthropomorphize TCP here, it's now thinking to itself, okay, I've sent my SYN, and my goal is to achieve a connection between 1.1.1.1, 1111, and 2.2.2.2, 2222. At exactly the same time, host 2 has done the same thing except with the parameters flipped around. Using source port 2222, it created a connection attempt to 1.1.1.1 port 1111. The important thing is, if we look at each side, they are working towards exactly the same goal. They both want a connection, and the four parameters of that connection, the two IPs and the two ports, are identical. What happens next is the two SYN packets pass each other on the network. That's why this process is so hard to do intentionally. If it takes 50 milliseconds for a packet to go from one host to the other, your hosts need to have their clocks synchronized within 50 milliseconds so that they send this packet at exactly the same time. Now each host receives the other host's SYN. They were probably expecting to get a SYNAC, the second step of the handshake, but they got this unexpected thing instead. So it's a bit weird, but all the addresses and ports line up. The host realizes that both ends are actually trying to establish the same connection. So they respond with a SYNAC. Remember that this combination of flags would normally be transmitted by a server, but TCP doesn't care. So they receive each other's SYNAC, and they respond to that with a final ACK. Now the connection is fully established. The call to connect on each program succeeds, and it's just like any other TCP connection. Now, I don't want to accidentally give you the impression that this is some sort of mystery or bug. It's a feature that shows up occasionally in real-world applications like NAT traversal. It's just that because of that overlap requirement, it's hard to use, so you generally just use a client-server approach. But it's fun to talk about two clients connecting to each other, even though that doesn't really make sense. So you're probably wondering at this point, can we do this in Rust? Well, actually, if we limited ourselves to the standard library, the answer would be no. TCP stream doesn't let us choose a source port for an outgoing connection. If each host just picks a source port at random, this won't work. However, there is a helpful crate called socket2, which contains some more advanced network functionality that isn't in the standard NET library. Here we have a socket struct that I can use to bind a source address manually and then turn it into a regular old TCP stream. With that functionality in hand, yes, we could do this in Rust. Let's hack together a simple test program, run it on some real computers, and observe what TCP is doing using tcpdump. This program is not too complicated. We take some command line parameters, wait until the clock says that it's time to connect, then hopefully we get a connection and do some I.O. Apart from setting the source port explicitly, there's nothing special about the network code at all. The cleverness of simultaneous open is handled within the operating system. Here is the first chunk. All we're doing first is reading in the command line arguments and making sure they pass as two ports and a string IP address. This is a toy program and I'm not going to handle all the errors. I'll just call unwrap when I have to. Next, we should try to bind our source port so that it's ready to go when the time comes. I've now brought in the socket2 library I showed earlier, created a socket and bound to a local address. You can see that I've constructed a string here, 0.0.0.0, concatenated with the chosen source port. When we bind a socket, we can't just specify the port by itself, but if we put in all zeros for the address, then the operating system will make a sensible choice for us. I bind and unwrap right away, which means if there's a problem acquiring the source port, I'll find out as soon as I run the program. Next, we must put the thread to sleep until the required time. When I run this program on two different computers, somehow they need to agree on a time to start the connection attempt. One obvious way to do that is to have an additional command line argument. Maybe I could type in a UTC time in hours, minutes, and seconds. But then I have to work out how to parse custom time strings and make sure it succeeds, and this seems like unnecessary work. Instead, I've decided to do something that can never fail. We will simply take the current time and round it up to the next minute. I'm not going to go into much detail here. Chrono is an awesome library, which is the one I'm using for this. And then we go to sleep for the calculated duration. One thing to watch out for is that thread sleep is not necessarily very accurate. To get millisecond or better precision, you need to rely on OS-specific features. Alternatively, you can thread sleep for most of the time, and when you get close, switch to a thread spinning in an infinite loop that is just constantly checking to see if the target time has arrived yet. There are crates that can help with this, but I'm not using any of them here. The two hosts I'm using in this test have about 50 milliseconds of delay between them, so I reckon the accuracy of plain old thread sleep will be enough. Now, last but certainly not least, we need to actually connect and try to send some data. Once the timer has expired, we simply call connect. This returns a result which will let us know whether our simultaneous open has worked or not, so we log it either way, and if it didn't work, we exit. Assuming we did get a connection, we convert it back into a regular TCP stream and send some data. This will be just a short string, hello. Then we'll receive whatever data we can from the other side and print it out to screen. The connection will remain open until we kill one of the two programs. Having written all that, I'll compile this for Linux, transfer it to my two hosts, and we can try it out. Let me explain what we have here. The two terminals on the top are my two hosts. At the bottom, I have a second shell to one of the hosts where I'm going to run TCP dump. These options show TCP dump show output more quickly, disable DNS lookups, and specifies that we're only interested in traffic that somehow involves port 11111, either as source or destination. This should allow us to watch the entire exchange. The two hosts I'm using today have global IPv4 addresses, so there is no NAT or anything to get in the way. One of them is in Singapore, and the other one I think is in Sydney, so they can connect directly to each other, but there's a little bit of latency. That's exactly what we want, to make sure those first SYN packets fly straight past each other. Before we start, let's verify that our clocks are in sync. Perfect. Let's give this a go. I've run the program on the two hosts, as you can see. In each case, I've specified the IP address of the opposite host and given them opposing source and destination ports. So they're going to wait until the agreed time. I ran them sort of near the start of the minute, which is good. So they have both chosen the exact same UTC time when they're actually going to connect. When they do, we'll see some output here, whether they think it worked or not, and be able to watch everything that happened here in TCP dump. There we go. We have apparently managed to connect. They both succeeded in their connection attempt. They both sent a string. They both received a string. And there was a whole bunch of stuff that happened down here. It happened really quickly, so I'm going to try and test my limited video editing skills, and maybe we can look at this in a bit more detail. Let's have a bit of a look at what happened in this TCP dump in slow motion, because there's timestamps on there, but it's a bit easier if you can see it come up in dribs and drabs of lines. So in the first line, the current machine has transmitted a packet outward to the other machine, and it's a SYN packet, which you can tell by that capital S in the square brackets there. Following that, we received an incoming SYN packet, so that means that the first two have overlapped, at least from the perspective of this machine, which is good. And it's also showing the SYN AX on the next line after that. In TCP dump, a full stop or a period represents the acknowledge flag. So far, everything is going well. Then after that, we transmit an acknowledgement for the SYN ACK that we just received. We hope to receive an ACK back for the SYN ACK that we sent out, which we do. And then those P1s that follow are where we're actually starting to send the data. You can see the sequence there is 1 to 7 because it contains the word hello and a new line. And then the connection is established. You can sort of see that the connection has been left open. If I quit the program on one end, then that will disconnect it on the other. So that worked a little bit too well. It almost makes it look easy. For another demo, let's change one of the clocks on one of these computers so that they don't manage to connect at exactly the same time. So what's the time on this machine? I'm going to change the time. So what this is going to do is at 14:16, it will change the time to 14:16:01, meaning that this machine will be slightly out of date. Let's see if that worked. Cool, so this machine down here is almost perfectly in sync with the upstream NTP servers. This one is almost 3/4 of a second out of time now. There's only 50 milliseconds latency between them, so probably this won't work anymore. Let's confirm that. This time we can see that it didn't work. We see that failed to connect on both hosts there. If we look down at TCP dump, we can see that one host sent a SYN and then got a reset from the other side. Then the second host sent a SYN and got a reset from the first host. So because those two SYNs didn't overlap over the internet, there was no chance for the simultaneous open to succeed. So you can see that this process is really very sensitive to timing. That's how you trigger a TCP simultaneous open with Rust. If you want to look at the code for yourself, I've put a link in the video description. Until next time, cheerio.